Everybody, welcome to this week's episode of Car Room Report. I'm Joe Kelly Jr. Now, as you could probably tell from the intro segment, we're going to be making some changes to Car Room Report as we go forward. We hope you like them, and we hope you like coming here every week to see a few model cars, hear a little bit about the hobby, and just enjoy collecting. Well, let's get right to it. There's a lot to talk about tonight, starting with this, our history car. Highway 61's Origins of Speed series was a very inspired lineup. Instead of replicating Megabuck hot rods with blown engines and custom interiors, these models replicated the very origins of speed. The scene on the streets back in the late 40s and early 50s, when Model A Fords got chopped and channeled and put over their rails, where skinny tires and wire wheels were the norm, and a four-cylinder engine got tweaked with all of the newly available speed equipment that was just starting to be manufactured, usually in California. I love these model cars, and this particular one, the red with the tan interior and the raked windshield on the Ford wire wheels with the little hubcaps, really speaks to the era. This is a beautiful piece. Nicely done all the way around, great paint on it, detail pieces that are very finely scaled, and man, that engine is unbelievable. It's a four banger, header on the one side, dual carbs on the other, some very funky rocker covers up on top, all kinds of tweaks to this car to make it go just that much better. This car has some neat features too, and I'm talking about the model now. The doors have real pin hinges, which always looks good on a model car regardless of the price point. It's got an opening trunk, steerable wheels, and one of the coolest things is that when you turn the rear wheels, the fan spins on the engine. Now, there's a caveat there. True to most of Highway 61's offerings, the fan spins backwards. If you look at it, the way the fan blades are angled would be pushing the air rather than pulling it through. Small price to pay for a pretty cool feature. These models were available originally for between $60 and $80, depending on the retailer. These days, you might have to poke around, but definitely do so. They came in beautiful packaging. They came with a booklet that talked about the origins of speed, and they just gave a lot of bang for the buck. Look them up. Well, let's talk about some cool 1/43rd scale cars from one of the real heavyweights in the small scale industry. That, of course, is Minichamps. These three models kind of give a cross section of what these guys can do. We have a full-on race car, a car that could be a race car, and we have something that is about as far from a race car as you can possibly get. This first model, Hans Joachim Stuck's car from the 1988 running of the Cleveland Trans Am. Now, Hans was the yodeler, and that day he got to sing. He won the race in this car. Of course, it's an Audi 200 Quattro, that wonderful all-wheel drive system that Audi does so much with. This is a great model car. I've seen a lot of good model cars come through with resin bodies and die-cast. When somebody can make die-cast metal look this good, it's fairly remarkable. The casting is hyper-accurate to the real thing. The decorations that they put onto the casting are equally as accurate, including this incredible tiny little antenna up on top. It is literally the thickness of a human hair. The lensing up in front, such as it is, being taped over, and in the rear, really echoes the quality that's seen on the rest of the car. Very finely done castings, and that's carried through to the wheels, and of course the full race interior with all of the roll cage elements and many of the electronics bolted in place. This is a great model car, on the market for between $50 and $60, one of only 2,448 that will be made. These guys love the limited editions. Now, let's talk about this. This was an exciting product, not only for Minichamps, but for fans of the Top Gear TV series. This, of course, is a figure of Stig standing in front of an equally white Bugatti Veyron. Now, this car ran a hot lap, 1 minute, 18.5 seconds. This, of course, is one of the features of Top Gear, where they'll take supercars and pit them against each other to see who takes the prize. Right behind the car, you also get to see its second place rating. Great graphic. This is a cool model car. Now, there's not a lot to look at inside some of these 43rd cars, but you do get some good interior detailing on this one, and a very decent view of the W16 quad turbocharged engine. In standard form, if there is anything related to standard on a Bugatti Veyron, it makes 1,001 horsepower. In super sport trim, it makes 1,200 horsepower. This is a very cool model. Of course, there's a lot of Veyrons out there, but if you like the 43rd, this is one you definitely want to consider. And hey, this little figure of Ben Collins, also known as the Stig, doesn't hurt. It's a nice presentation. Now, Pokey is thy name if you drive a Smart for two. These cars have appeared here. They've been around for just a couple of years, and they are, to say the least, different kinds of automobiles. This model, as done by Minichamps, has an awful lot of charm. First of all, it's about the size of an egg, a small egg, but it replicates what is one of the upscale versions of the Smart for two. This coupe has a see-through roof done in a nice amber tint, a full-on interior done in red and black, and just about all of the detailing you could ask for, even on a model of a much larger scale. The wheels are done beautifully. The lensing, always a bone of contention with me, is done impeccably on this one, and so is the glazing. You can look into the cabin on this thanks to some down-position side windows, and you'll see some very nicely textured, very nicely detailed door panels, seats, and an incredibly detailed dashboard. This is a funky, funky little model. Again, limited edition, one of 1,536 that are going to be made. They're going to do a bunch of colors of these, again, on the market for between $50 and $60. Poke around, check out CarvilleModels.com. They seem to be a good stockist for any of the Minichamps products, and see what you can find. A couple of months ago, we had the opportunity to go into Nuremberg and interview some very interesting people, and one of the most enjoyable interviews was this one with Paul Lang. Paul Lang, of course, is the president of Minichamps, and he told us about the history of the company, his enjoyment of the industry, and the surprising team he has around him to run the Minichamps empire. Check this out. Minichamps, you know the name. This is a brand that's been around for decades, one of the finest quality product out there on the market, and also a family business. Well, we're lucky. We need the man himself, Mr. Paul Lang, the head of Minichamps. All these years we've been coming to the show, this is the first time we actually got to see it.
Oh, why, you haven't not passed by?
Well, I've been hiding, actually.
Oh, Jesus. You have missed the best thing on the whole show in diecast.
Well, this isn't just a booth. This is an event. You've got this giant stand here. Outside, it's metal. You have a working espresso bar in the front, and, as usual, a beautiful, real car parked in the front.
It's a 956.
956.
Which has been driven from the Hansstuck, which is coming on Sunday.
He'll be here.
He will be here because we're introducing this year the Hansstuck collection, and he will be here on Sunday.
Well, you have made, for years, you have made some of the finest product in the industry. And are you the person who makes the decisions? Do you pick these models to do?
I'm the person who's doing finally the decision, but we have a very good team. Mm-hmm. And so we have our brainstorming. There are a lot of ideas, but the owner of the company is my wife and me, so that means we have to pay the bill. So the final decision then is made by the boss who has to pay the bill. And by the way, thank you very much that you appreciate our stand. And I'm responsible for the cars, but for all others, for the interior design, my wife is responsible for that.
She does a wonderful job. This is real. It's spectacular. It's absolutely spectacular.
Well, so is the product. Now, we see a lot of new stuff outside. You said this company had its roots, its very beginnings, in 1971, but then in 1990 became Minichamps.
Right, that's correct.
Now, there's also a Minichamps museum in Aachen.
We have, I think, worldwide the biggest model car museum and the most beautiful museum, because it's been also designed by my wife. Interior, I'm responsible then for the exterior, that means for the model cars, right, which are shown there. And the company, I'm coming out of family business. The company has been founded by my grandfather in 1921.
Okay.
Toys have been luxury before the Second World War. And after the Second World War, it has come more toy shop. Before, they have sold bicycles, motorbikes, washing machines, etc., etc. And so with the, if Germany is coming more and more healthy, so the toy business has come much, much bigger in Germany. And then the model trains have come in, model cars have come in, etc., etc. And I have come into the business in 1971 as our friends from merry old England have created nearly all of our hobbies and sports.
Right.
And one of their hobbies, big hobbies, has been collecting model cars and manufacturing model cars, because they have been one of the first in the middle 30s that they have come up with diecast, besides Märklin here in Germany. And I've enjoyed model cars. I must say I'm not a collector. I like the design on model cars, and especially my most favorite designs is 30s and 40s, with the most beautiful coach building. And so I've gone to England to negotiate an exclusive distribution for white metal kits. There was John Day, and he was one of creator of white metal kits for model cars.
Right.
Bob Wills has made the first ones. John Day has made the first in 43rd scale, besides auto replicas Barry Lester, and these we have imported, and so the whole business has started. And my passion has been always to produce and create quality, and slogan of Minichamps is quality comes first. And so I've manufactured around 20 years white metal models. I've started this with John Day in England, then over Resto models in England, and then finally my wife and me have purchased AMR in Paris. He was the most genius model maker in these days for white metal kits, also fully finished models. And but this has been hand-built stuff, and prices have become higher and higher. In the late 80s, you have paid for 43rd scale fully finished models, model between 350 to 500 Deutschmarks, which is equivalent these days around $250, and which was a lot of money. And so I've thought about where I can manufacture these quality handmade, but for a much, much better price.
For broader market,
Broader market, of course. And so in China, I've come the first economy zone in Shenzhen, was have been set up from Mr. Deng, the former Chinese prime minister. And so I was the first European who has gone over to China and to look for quality. And so finally, we have teach them to make quality models.
Uh-huh.
And that was Minichamps. And I've found my dream that we really could make a handmade model for a much broader market, because people have been really surprised on the toy show in 1991 how cheap the models have been. Because they have all thought, oh, it costs 150 Deutschmarks, and they will say to them, sorry, it's 29.50. Huh? They couldn't believe it.
43rd is a scale that was never really accepted in America, but now is finally getting energy. Now, I know that you're going to play a big role in that moving forward. You must be excited to see that people starting to love that scale.
That is really good news to hear that from the States, because, as you say, the Americans always, as a country, is as bigger as better, and those they have always preferred larger scales, and started with 24 scale, 18 scale, or scale 112, and so I'm happy to hear that, and because in 43rd scale, you have really the biggest variety in the model car market today, and that is also the scale where you have each year the most new items anyway.
Right, right. And you're also now branching out. You do die cast traditionally, but you're also now doing the models in resin. To get like a little bit of what is the advantage to the resin versus the die cast?
The advantage of the resin is, of course, you can produce, the development time is much quicker.
Uh-huh.
And especially if you take the resin seasons each year getting shorter. And so we have made the decision to make a part of our racing car models also in resin and to be quicker to the market.
Uh-huh.
That's really cool.
That's amazing stuff. And I mean, every year we come here, and I'm just blown away by not just the spectacle of this booth, but the product you bring out, the thought that goes into it, and the quality. I wish you many, many more years of success with this. You do wonderful stuff, and it's a pleasure to finally shake your hand.
Thank you very much, and best regards to our fellows in America, and hopefully we're getting more and more clients for Minichamps, especially collecting 143rd. I would be happy about that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to thank Paul Lang for taking the time to talk to us, and I want to thank Alan Moreau for getting that all together for us over at Nuremberg. Hey, we're going to take a quick commercial break. When we come back, we're going to be looking at Sword models and speaking with the man himself, Chuck Sword. Stay right where you are.
Talk about play sets. Remember, keyword, play sets. Hot Wheels cars are meant to be played with. Here you got Crisscross Crash, 1992-1993. Notice the cars going through here, smacking each other, chipping each other up. I love this set. Don't take your red lines and put them through here, okay? This set's a lot of fun. Here's a better shot of it out back. Cars, and really, see how the cars are flying off of the package? That's how it really was. You send your cars through here, they hit each other, but it was a great time. Took you about half an hour, 45 minutes to set it up, but once you got it going, put the batteries in there, it was a great, great time. Remember, play sets. These things are meant to be played with, not just sit on the shelf, okay? We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Mike Zarnock, and you're watching Car Room TV.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Car Room Report. Now, if you're a fan of over-the-road truck models, you've probably heard of Sword. If you haven't heard of Sword, you really should. These are great, great model trucks and heavy equipment. Tonight, we're going to be talking about some over-the-road trucks in 350th scale. Very popular scale for this type of collectible. Right here we have a Peterbilt 357 with an East Genesis dump body. And of course we've got this Freightliner Century tractor with a Brenner chemical tanker attached to it. I love these models. I'm not a truck collector, never really started it, but things like this pull you in just because they're so beautifully done. The feature list and details on these things really belongs on a model that's at least twice the size. You're looking at working suspensions, posable steering, full engine detailing, photo-etched grille, horns up on the top, a full interior inside, chassis detailing that includes, believe it or not, all of the brake and electrical cabling. These are just unbelievable. This East Genesis dump body on this Peterbilt 357, in real life, it's an aluminum piece that actually saves quite a lot of weight, yet still is able to haul megatons of whatever it is they need to move. Here, it's done in a beautiful aluminum finish, and it's got a lot of working features. Of course, there's a great replication of the hydraulic ram under the dump body. We've got a removable, real fabric top on it with the bows to keep it up over the load, and we've got working tailgates and a working drop gate with a little lever that would allow you to just dump some of the load out if you needed to. I love models that are this detailed. There's a little bit of hands-on with these models. When you take them out of the box, you have to put the mirrors onto the truck. Now, that can be a little tedious, and you do want to use just a dab of white glue. The bottom line is that when it's done, you've got an unbelievable display piece. Same deal here. This incredible Schneider Trucking Freightliner tractor is just about as good as it gets. One of the things that makes this such an eye grabber is this full metal Brenner chemical tanker in the back. It's a beautifully polished piece, fashioned from a single tube of some type of metal that's been chromed and polished, and then decorated with photo-etched railings, a full valve assembly, full suspension in the back, all of the pipes and fittings that you could possibly imagine, and of course, it's attached to this tractor up in the front. This tractor, all by itself, this Freightliner, is a model that's really worth looking into. Again, you need to attach a couple pieces. You do want to use white glue, especially for these fender-mounted fisheye mirrors in the front and these side-mounted mirrors with the complete antennas up on the top. It's pretty trick pieces. We've got coiled springs that replicate the brake and electrical connections for the trailer. We've got a working fifth wheel, working steering, tilted nose, full engine detailing, and a full interior. One of the cool things about this particular model is that if you can't get enough of that interior looking through the opening doors, you can pop the top right off the truck and look right down into the little rolling hotel that these trucks are. These are really beautiful pieces. Prices on these vary depending on availability and complexity. Some of these models, believe it or not, can get to over 3 feet long. That's for the bridge beam haulers in the 3x3x3. Hey, you're going to hear about that 3x3x3 in the upcoming video. We had a chance to talk to Chuck Sword at Nuremberg, and he is one of the nicest guys, a good friend, and really into what he does. Check this out. Nuremberg 2011, we are here with the man, Chuck Sword. When you talk about commercially available, well, dude, you are, dude. When you want to talk about heavy equipment, construction equipment, trucks, Sword Collectibles has been out there for a long time, servicing a lot of collectors. Look at the smile on this guy's face. He's happy doing it. How are you, man?
Good, good. How are you? Good to see you, Joe.
I'm great. Good to see you, too. Just a happy accident. You know, this is the kind of thing that happens at Nuremberg. People just bumping into each other. Now we look at this is off the hook.
Yeah, how about that, huh? Yeah, we've done a couple new models this year, and we won a couple of awards, too, so I'm very excited to show some of the new stuff. And we're at our distributor's booth for Europe. The company's called Spiel Model Kistel, and he's done a very great job for us over here. So, you know, we've got good distribution in the USA. He handles everything in Europe. It's a lot easier for me.
Really important, though, right? I mean, a lot of people don't realize that. They think that manufacturers make a model and they magically appear on the shelves. You need that contact.
Absolutely. And it's a hard, lot of hard work. It's hard work. And the European continent, I mean, the whole, the people over here are so much more interested in diecast even than the US. I think that people over here are far way ahead of everybody. They like model kit building. They like diecast. They like to collect. Things that we hope that the US people will start to pick up a little bit more even.
Let's get philosophical for a second. Do you think it's because the European lifestyle is more geared toward leisure time and hands-on activities, not so much watching television, going to the movies?
Absolutely, absolutely. I think that people grow up in Europe thinking of building things, and making a model kit is not something that's outlandish. And in the US, they're playing video games when they're kids. Here, they're building things. They're being outside more. And I think there's a lot more tradition and a lot more of that passed on from father to son, et cetera, et cetera. And unfortunately, I think in the US, it's not so much.
See, we're always run, run, run. These guys are fun, fun, fun.
It's right. That's probably true. Yeah, that's very true. Good way to look at it. It's a good way to look at it. Yeah, absolutely.
Where's the award-winning model? Let's talk.
It's kind of stuck in the back here, but you can see it a little bit. Stuck in the back is called Oshkosh is the company that manufactures it. It's an HET, which is a heavy equipment transport, and basically it's a tank transporter. The version we see here is sand color. Obviously, it's used in Iraq, desert type conditions. There's also a camo version, which matches the tank that's in front. So those two models, basically, we made 1,000 of them. They sold out immediately. We're completely out. I can't even get you one, Joe. I'm sorry.
That's cool.
But no, they were sold very well, and Toy Trucker Magazine named it the number one model for 2010. So very excited.
And that's a real finicky crowd. These guys know the trucks, and they don't play around. They know that. That's cool. You know what? Anytime a model sells out, we don't get one. That's the good news. That's all right.
Right, exactly. Yeah, we hope they sell out. We want everyone to sell out, absolutely.
Absolutely.
But we do limited editions for that reason, you know. So, you know, we only do a certain number, and then after that, it's done, you know.
Which really, that keeps the model's value up there. It really gets the collectors happy.
Absolutely, and it becomes a true collectible. Yep. You know, if somebody's making 20, 30,000 or something, it's not necessarily, I would call it a collectible.
Right.
We'll make 1,000, we'll make 2,000, that's it. And that's the end, and we'll make something else.
Yep.
So there's lots of product to make. So we have exciting. It's exciting.
You've got a really varied cross platform. Up here, we've got the Superior Telestacker. We did a review on this a couple of years back on the Playing with Cars series. The complexity of these models. This is not something you just go out and produce. This is not a slipshod process. You need to really be exact about this.
Absolutely. It takes over a year to produce a model like this, and it's involving CAD drawings directly from the manufacturer. It involves, you know, thousands and thousands of photographs crawling under the machines. We've done it ourselves. I've done it myself for some of our big 3x3x3 loader in a snowstorm.
I think we're under attack.
Yeah, I think so. Duck. So the 3x3x3 loader, we crawled underneath. We had to get all the information for underneath, so we're in the snow and the rain, etc., etc. So yeah, it goes crazy. It's just crazy.
It's hands-on. It's really hands-on. Well, the amazing thing about these, and again, something we brought up with John back at the other booth, the size of these models, 1/50th scale, you would think there would be a limit to what could be done function-wise. That doesn't seem to be a problem for you guys. You've got opening cabs, you've got steering wheels, tilting noses, the engine detailing. That's got to feel great when you see that finished product come back.
Absolutely. Everything is in metal. We don't do any plastic. The people want to be able to heft, it has to have heft to it.
Right.
It has to have a weight to it to make it interesting for us. And we're trying to do everything with metal. So yeah, there are some limitations you get to, but we keep pushing and pushing, and the manufacturers are getting better and better. So we try to bring in something that nobody's ever seen before. So it's very exciting, especially when we kind of push it to see how far we can go.
Yeah. Keep pushing, man. I mean, some of this stuff is crazy. We see these beautiful Kenworths down here, Peterbilts. We've got Max. We've got some heavy construction equipment down here. This is a great lineup. And, you know, as we said in the booth, you bring so much to the hobby, and you just keep doing it, man. Keep doing it.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And thanks for your time.
My pleasure. Thank you. Thank you.
It was was great bumping into Chuck at Nuremberg. It's just that kind of show, and he's just such a great guy to talk to. Hey, you know, if there's something you want to see on the show, whether it's equipment, airplanes, whatever it might be, contact me, joe@thecarroom.com. We'd be only too happy to get your models on the show. And if there's something you'd like to ask us, if you have some reader mail you'd like to send our way, we're going to be starting a new feature next week called Reader Mail. So please, send your letters to joe@thecarroom.com and join us on our YouTube page under The Car Room, one word, or join us on Facebook at The Car Room. It'll keep you up to date on doings with the magazine, new models, exclusive photographs, and just all of the info that you might want to know about the hobby. Okay, stick around. We're going to take another quick commercial break. When we come back, we're going to go big with Kyosho's amazing Enzo Ferraris. Stay right there. You want to talk about luxury, you want to talk about high performance, you want to talk about a model car that the hobby's been crying for, here it is, Kyosho's 1/18 scale Rolls-Royce Ghost. This thing is amazing. The finish on it is almost impeccable, even as a pre-production. It's a fully opening model, opening trunk, opening doors, opening hood, and get this, it's even got a replica of the little umbrella that's hidden inside the passenger door. It's got a working suspension, steel brake discs behind the wheels. This is really scrupulous stuff. Here's the killer. Just like the real car, when you roll the model, the Rolls-Royce hub in the center of the wheels stays dead straight up and down. This is really imaginative modeling, and I can't wait for it to hit our shores. Stay tuned. We're going to let you know when that day comes.
This is John DeAgostino, you're watching Car Room TV.
back to Car Room Report. You know, 12 scale is getting a lot of traction in the hobby these days. Whether you're a collector who's looking for a centerpiece for your collection, or you have the space and the financial wherewithal to really explore what the scale has to offer, there's some great, great stuff out there. Now, last week we had a Lamborghini Miura SV on, of course, made by Kyosho. Kyosho's back again this week with this pair of Ferrari Enzos. I like this pairing a lot because, though it isn't marketed as such, it more or less replicates the very first and the very last of the Ferrari Enzos. The first Ferrari Enzo that many of us saw was the car that Demi Moore drove in Charlie's Angels Full Throttle. Now, who can forget Demi Moore in a black bikini rolling up in a red Ferrari Enzo? The last one, well, a little more serious, a little more sedate. It was the black car that was presented to the Pope by Michael Schumacher. Of course, the car was later sold, went to charity, and to a lot of good causes. These are really entertaining model cars. In a world where bigger isn't always better, Kyosho seems to bring all the details out with some very thoughtful and some very cleverly used materials. Of course, it's mostly die-cast, which makes the model very heavy in hand. But the plastic bits that have been put in here have been decorated really nicely. There's a lot of carbon fiber detailing. Very glossy, very believable. There's also a lot of photo etch. It's used in some of the badging, in most of the screening, including the downward-firing radiators in the front, and the screening in the back of the car. When you open the gullwing doors, pop open the trunk with the hidden button under the nose, and of course bring up the engine cover and put it on its strut, this thing really comes alive. The carbon fiber detailing on the fender wells and on top of the 651 horsepower V12 engine are remarkably realistic. That's the real buzzword with these models. They are truly realistic. The shut lines, the paint, the quality of these things is top shelf. If you really want to have fun, you can watch the working suspension when you press down on it with this push rod coilover suspension in the back and in the front, and you can also remove the wheels to reveal the carbon ceramic brake discs and the Brembo Ferrari calipers. Like these models a lot. Again, if you're looking for a halo piece, it doesn't get much better than that. Well, that does it for this episode of Car Room Report. Once again, guys, we ask you to join us on Facebook under The Car Room. Join us on YouTube to watch these clips in high def under The Car Room, all one word. If there's a model you'd like to see, a letter you'd like us to read on air, or any kind of comment about the magazine or the show, please email me, joe@thecarroom.com. On behalf of everybody here at The Car Room, thanks for coming down. Thanks for playing with cars. We'll see you next week.
Okay, Dad.